until the heart of our city commission is touched to the point that they will agree to sit down as men of intelligence and men of dedication and wisdom to discuss these problems with the leaders of the Negro race.
It happens almost every day in the city of Albany, Georgia. A prayer on the sidewalks outside City Hall, directed not just at the conscience of the city fathers, but at the attention of the world outside. On the city's side, the pattern is patience and then arrest.
Imagine crowds, you've been here for 15 minutes or 30 minutes. Now you can either go, you're through with your prayers and you're through with your disturbance here.
Hey, did I know you even a man? I know you made us all and you know all of that. I know the world and they put it down all this again. Please, Lord. Please, Jesus. Have mercy on me, baby.
I would like to play a little tune I just composed not so long ago.
Miss Billie Holiday.
The music called jazz. Should I say the mother, bringing us back again from the drumming on the Congo. It came with a strong flow and continued to grow. Feet moved to the beat of the tabalo. Now dig the story and follow, for then it landed on American soil. Through the sweat, the blood, and the toil, it praised the Lord, shouted on chain gangs. Pain they felt, but it helped them to maintain. Scott Joplin grass, Bessie Smith's blues, St. Louis blues, they were all the news, ringing smooth in all the listeners' ears, fulfilling the needs and planting the seeds of a jazz thing. King Oliver's group was a train coming through to Chicago, bringing in New Orleans groove. And with Satchmo Blue, the audience knew Basin Street Blues was the whorehouse tune. It was music great to dance to, great to romance to, with a lot to say to you, relaying a message, revealing the essence of a jazz thing. In the 40s came bebop, the first bebop, the real bebop. So let me talk about Diz and Bird, giving the word, defining how a beat could be so complete. Playing with ferocity, thinking with velocity, about ornithology or anthropology, and even epistrophe, and this is real history. Thelonious Monk, a melodious thunk, no mistakes were made with the notes he played. His conception was recondite, a star glowing bright among dim lights. The critics did cite that he sounded all right, and Charlie Mingus, such nimble fingers, dropping the bass all over the place. And Max Roach, cymbal socking, bass drum talking, snare drum rocking, restructuring the metaphysics of a jazz thing. John Coltrane, a man supreme, he was the cream, he was the wise one, the impression of Afro blue and of the promise that was not kept. He was a giant step, and there was Ornette Coleman, he was another soul man, the original invisible, playing great music. I wonder why the bankers couldn't use it. Now listen, see, the real mystery is how music history created by white men or any other white man, and pretended he originated, and contended that he innovated a jazz thing.
Of course we know who could really blow,
scheming on the meaning of a jazz thing. And this music ain't dead, so don't be misled by those who said that jazz is on its deathbed, 'cause when Betty Carter sings a song, ain't nothing going on but simply good music, and you won't refuse it. She's taking her time making the nuances rhyme. Sonny Rollins, tenor saxophone with a big old tone, reciting poems with notes as words. And haven't you heard? Next stop Butter, right past Olio. Now there's young cats blowing, and more people, yes, they will be knowing. Jazz ain't the past, this music's gonna last. And as the facts unfold, remember who foretold the 90s will be the decade of a jazz thing.
I love jazz music.
A jazz thing.
I love jazz music.
A jazz thing.
I love jazz music. I love jazz music.
A jazz thing.
Until the heart of our city commission is touched to the point that they will agree to sit down as men of intelligence and men of dedication and wisdom to discuss these problems with the leaders of the Negro race. And
it happens almost every day in the city of Albany, Georgia. A prayer on the sidewalks outside City Hall, directed not just at the conscience of the city fathers, but at the attention of the world outside. On the city side, the pattern is patience and then arrest.
You've been here for 15 minutes or 30 minutes. Now you can either go, you're through with your prayers and you're through with your disturbance here.
It's hard to object to someone at prayer. It's the special tactic of the Albany movement to wage the struggle for Negro civil rights in the South in ways that are hard to object to. This is what makes Albany, Georgia, different from the other battlefields of racial desegregation. The technique requires great discipline from the Negroes and demands great restraint from the white population. So far, with few exceptions, there has been both discipline and restraint, and this also makes Albany different. The Negroes' key demand is for negotiations, negotiations on something the South has always held to be not negotiable, the end of segregation. The city officials have not negotiated, but they have not allowed violent retaliation either. Yet the threat of violence hangs over the scene. Both sides have laid down boundaries beyond which they're trying not to go. In doing so, they have changed the terms of the struggle between white and black in the South. This is the subject of tonight's Eyewitness Report. Your correspondent, Charles Collins.
Eyewitness, the big news of this week. Tonight, witness, the Albany Movement. Brought to you by Excedrin, the extra strength pain reliever. New Excedrin from Bristol Myers.
In the Deep South, if the Negro has something to say, he says it in church. Down here, he has no social organization, no political power. The church is his only forum. Any appeal for action by Negroes comes from the pulpit, expressed in the terms and the tunes of that old-time religion. In the congregations of Albany, Georgia, the old gospel hymns are now being sung with new verses about civil rights and lunch counter sit-ins. And the sermons are about the promise of desegregation through peaceful but persistent pressure. The preacher, W.G. Anderson, an Albany osteopath and founder of the Albany movement.
Everybody wants to know when. Everybody wants to know what. Well, we have waited for these past 100 years following the Emancipation Proclamation, and we haven't got tired of waiting. Our patience has not gone thin because those things that we want, we have wanted for these past 100 years. And if necessary, we'll wait another 100 years. But we will keep on pressing in that direction. Now, many of us have been standing by with our bootstraps laced up, ready to march. You know this, the people downtown know this, this is known all over the world. And somehow or another, when they know that you are determined to stand up for these things in which you believe, at least they have to stop and give reckon to it. Now, we don't have any Rockefellers in our midst. We don't have any Henry Fords. We don't have any Roosevelts or even Kennedys. We don't have any Ruthers or Hoffers. But we do have a king. We've got Martin Luther King.
The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. of Atlanta, Georgia, has become the leading voice in the Albany movement as he has in other desegregation movements. He has encouraged Albany Negroes to lace up their boots and start marching down to the city hall to pray and from there to jail. The jails in towns all around Albany are jammed with Negroes. For a while, King cheered them on from the outside, as in a visit to a jail in the nearby town of Camilla, about 25 miles down the road from Albany.
Fine, fine. Dr. Steele, what are the conditions there? Is it crowded?
Yes, very crowded.
How many is that cell supposed to hold?
They don't hold very many because we all sleep on the floor and some of them.
Is that so?
10.
It's built to hold 10. And they have 69 in there. Uh-huh.
Well, how about the food, C.K.?
We get grits and gravy in the morning, yesterday and today, rice and gravy in the evening, two slices of bread and meat, no coffee, hot water coming out of the bed. We sleep on the table.
Is that so?
What's your name? What's your name?
Jerome Jackson.
Who hit you? Lerone Jackson?
Write that down. What do you mean? Quote that.
Camilla Police.
Is that Lerone or Jerome?
J-R-O-L-E.
Jerome what?
Jackson.
Jackson. And a Camilla policeman hit you?
Yeah.
With a flashlight?
There have been charges of police brutality. There was also an incident of cop baiting by a few Negroes. But the general pattern has been one of restraint on both sides, like the atmosphere outside City Hall when King was confronted by Police Chief Laurie Pritchett.
All right, now you had your prayer, you made your point, now let's move out, or you're under arrest. Either one now, doesn't make any difference to me.
Martin Luther King joining his followers in public prayer and then in jail.
Chief, what instructions have you given your men concerning the handling of Negro demonstrations? Particularly.
We have schooled our men here, and I think the result speaks for itself, that they have done an outstanding job in the handling of these situations. We knew that their theory was nonviolence, so we based our theory on nonviolence also, and I think this is what has stunned them, that they were expecting police brutality, they were expecting the police to come in on them, which has not happened. We have had no instances here involving the activities or the conduct of police officers, and I contribute this to the fact that we have schooled them, we have orientated them, conducted classes, and I think this has paid off in big dividends to the city of Albany and to law enforcement.
Chief Pritchett has warned that his men are only human and that patience wears thin. Negro leaders have suggested a little wryly that the police take a lesson in patience from Southern Negroes. The truce in Albany prevails, however taut the situation beneath the surface. But the campaign of nonviolence and even the terms of the truce itself are having their impact on Albany, as we'll see in a moment in a report from the scene. First, this message.
To those around you, you look fine. But underneath, you feel pain. If pain really bothers you, if you want something extra, now from Bristol-Myers, here is the new Extra Strength Pain Reliever. Here is Excedrin. Here are extra relief-giving ingredients. A fast-action pain reliever, a long-lasting pain reliever, a tension reliever to relax you, an antidepressant to restore you. Excedrin has more active ingredient than any other leading tablet. Tablet for tablet, Excedrin is 50% stronger than aspirin for headache. And yet, you need no prescription for extra strength Excedrin. So now, for temporary relief of minor arthritic pain, cold discomforts, sinus, headache, combat pain with Excedrin, the new extra strength pain reliever.
As they say in the real estate ads, Albany, Georgia is a neighborly little city, but the neighbors are divided by more than back fences, for Albany is really two communities, one white, one black. Correspondent Hughes Rudd has spent the last few weeks visiting both halves.
The first thing you notice about Albany is the heat. This is South Georgia, 150 feet above sea level, and the sun glares and burns as though nature hated man and wished him gone. The metal of motor cars is too hot to touch, and collars are wet and crumpled, and everyone seeks the shade where he can, when he can. It's this heat which brought Albany into existence. It's inhuman, but it makes cotton snap out of the ground almost before your very eyes, and cotton made Albany, the town and the trouble. More than 100 years ago, this was a trading center surrounded by plantations of pecans and cotton and slaves. And today, it's still a trading center surrounded by plantations of cotton and pecans and Negroes. In South Georgia, Negro and white work together, but after hours, they go their separate ways. The Negroes to the district called Harlem, a neighborhood of rundown houses on unpaved streets. On the fringes of Albany, you find the new homes of a new class, the few Negro professional people and businessmen. Harlem does have its own swimming pool, and like the schools of Albany, it's separate but equal. It has its own grocery stores, its own taverns, its own restaurants, its own barber shops. The Negroes even have their own taxis. Good jobs for Negroes are scarce except in the blistering cotton fields, and if you don't choose to chop cotton, you just hang around thinking about the whites and talking about the whites.
Has been laboring under the false assumption that when everything is quiet, everybody is satisfied. There has been somewhat of a pseudo-peace existing in the city of Albany that has been conditioned by oppression over a period of years waged against the Negro community.
It's only two blocks from the center of Harlem to uptown Albany, but for the Negroes, those are long, long blocks. And when you do get uptown, you find a pleasant southern city of 31,000 whites moving rather slowly under the summer sun in their own segregated swimming pools, their own segregated residential districts, their own segregated city parks. Negroes are allowed in the white parks, but not for pleasure, and the whites can't understand why they do want in.
We have a very dense Negro population in this southwest Georgia area. And the fact that over the years, Albany has enjoyed excellent race relations between the Negroes and the whites. We have never had trouble until the coming of the outside unwanted agitators.
I asked Albany hotel manager Victor Geiger, do you think Negroes will ever be given rooms in your hotel?
That's a pretty hard question to answer, too. That someday they might, but I don't think during my tenure of management, I think it'll be a longer time off than that, much longer time off than that.
Now, we've said many times before that the object is not to destroy our white brothers, but the object is to destroy the system that enslaves both our white brothers and ourselves. So that when we go today to the lunch counters, when we go today to the parks, we won't be speaking back harshly to anyone. We're going about our business quietly, dignified manner, because we realize that our actions not only affect ourselves and our parents, but they affect Albany, the Negro community, they affect the Negro community throughout this country and the best thinking people in this country and the whole cause of justice. So each of our actions are important. We don't want to be chewing gum, and we want to be very dignified and all this. Now, one of the songs we sing, we sung in the jails of Albany, we sung on the streets and in the mass meetings, is called If You Miss Me. And I think you all know this one. It goes like this. If you miss me from the Harlem drug, you can't find me nowhere.
Besides segregated lunch counters and parks, another target is the public library, where Negroes must enter through the basement and are not allowed to browse.
You should have been down there to see those students this afternoon at their library. Now, when the kids went down, the library was open. And when they were approaching the entrance, the white man walked in before them, and I assume that he notified the people that the teenager was on their way. When they got there, a man held the door closed and then locked it. And so they weren't admitted in. So they crowded to the entrance and they stood there for a minute. And then they kneeled down and sung some songs. And then they prayed. But you should have been down there this afternoon to see 15 young people down on their knees, crowded at the entrance of the library, singing and praying. And this is unusual. For a bunch of teenagers. I mean, these kids, I doubt if any of them were over 15 years of age, singing and praying, and knowing what they were, they knew what they were doing. They knew what they were doing, and they meant what they were doing from the depth of their heart. In the church today, we got up, just like we said here, the kids discussed it. It was their own decision. Nobody pushed them into it. And they didn't walk to the paddy wagon. They were limp. Nonviolent direct action, inaction. One of the exponents of this technique is the Reverend Wyatt T. Walker of Atlanta, who travels as an aide to Martin Luther King. Eyewitness reporter Philip Scheffler asked him whether he thought his group had made any impact on the conscience of Albany.
I think we have. Here again is a reservation that many people who do not quite understand what we're doing, this is one of the reservations that they hold. They say you can't change men's hearts. We may not change the immediate opposition, but the use and the technique of the nonviolent direct action program flushes the system of segregation into the public arena where people's minds and eyes and ears have to grapple with the rightness or wrongness of it. And whereas I might not, we might not sear Chief Pritchett's conscience or Mayor Kelly's conscience, there are many moderate whites who have not clearly seen the issues because they have been shut off from what the real plight of the Negro is. And when this is...
Why have they been shut off from this?
Well, here again is a biblical similarity. I suppose the greatest insult that there can be to a people is to be ignored. And the Negro community, by and large, has been ignored as an entity in the communities in the South.
Do you think, really, that these white people, even those of, we'll say, potential good feeling, don't or haven't really known what it's like to be a Negro in the South?
I don't think any white person can really understand what it is to be a Negro in America.
Mm-hmm. For Negroes in the South, one of the most significant facts of life is that they don't vote. There are more than 5 million Negroes of voting age in the South, but only 25% of them exercise that right. Once they break through the barriers in great numbers, they could turn things upside down, not just in Albany, as Martin Luther King has said, but in the entire South. The Albany meetings, the prayers, the sit-ins, the deliberate courting of arrest, in these moves, the immediate hope is not desegregation. It is instead to give the rural and small town Negro the self-confidence to face up to the guardians of the real sanctum, the voting booth. And the Albany movement seems to be doing what it's intended to do. The Negroes are learning defiance in the face of white supremacy, real or implied. And the whites, in turn, are alarmed and also incredulous, and in Albany at least, they seem to be more determined than ever to maintain segregation. Albany is a place in which white men still speak of my Negroes and your Negroes, and they really cannot believe that these things are being brought about by their Negroes, but only by outsiders. The whites then still resist change, but for the first time in Albany, desegregation is a sidewalk issue, and when the whites talk about it, it's not quite with the old conviction. And the Negroes continue to press forward. Maybe they really expect the walls of Jericho to come tumbling down. Maybe they don't. But they are trying to make enough noise to be heard in high places. And they were, this week, in the White House, as we'll see in a moment.
You ready? Here we go. Now come over here. What do we do?
Press this. Press this button.
Press the button?
Number 2, press up the button.
Now what?
Number 3, oh.
That's right. 3 and 4 and pull the tab. What's that saying?
1, 2, 3, 4. Open the door and count to 10 and open the door.
Well, are you going to count to 10?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 12, 14, 16, 18, 10.
Good. Now what?
Open the door.
Now we open the door, peel out the picture. How do you like this picture?
It's terrific.
I've been in constant touch with the Attorney General and received more or less daily reports, and he's been in daily touch with the authorities in Albany in an attempt to provide a solution. There is a What is involved here is partly local laws and partly those laws which involve the national government, particularly as they might involve public facilities, and some of these matters are in the court. Let me say that I find it wholly inexplicable why the City Council of Albany will not sit down with the citizens of Albany, who may be Negroes, and attempt to secure to them in a peaceful way their rights. The United States government is involved in sitting down at Geneva with the Soviet Union. I can't understand why the government of Albany, City Council of Albany, cannot do the same for American citizens.
We would be happy to discuss the local problems with any of the local Negroes, provided they are not lawbreakers. However, I would like to mention that the remedy of the Negroes is in the courts of competent jurisdiction and not through the violation of ordinances and statutes.
Do you think that the problems that the Negroes say they have are negotiable in that sense, or do you think that the only solution is to go into the courts?
It has been my position, and it has been the position of the City Commission over the past 18 months, that their remedy and redress is in the federal courts.
If the federal court were to say to the City of Albany that you must desegregate your presently segregated facilities, such as the library and the pool and other public facilities, would you do it then?
The City of Albany is composed of law-abiding citizens. We have always complied with the orders of federal courts, and I think would comply in the future.
We have learned, of course, that we're not going to change the hearts of these people by any court order or by any degree of legislation. But we have learned that the heartless can be restrained. And it is not until among the millions of white demagogues in the South who have in their breast, where there should be a heart, heartlessness, will there be police brutality, the indignities which are heaped upon us. And I want you to know that as long as people from among you, people like you and you and you and you, continue to express yourselves through these peaceful protest demonstrations, something's got to give.
The Negro leadership in the South has shown in Albany, Georgia, that they've perfected a very sophisticated technique for pressing their case. They've brought their struggle to the attention of the whole world. As Hughes Rudd said, they've given their own people self-confidence. They seem to have shaken somewhat the confidence of the whites. They've enlisted the sympathy of the President of the United States. The Albany movement is a technique based on the church, on the doctrines of nonviolence, and on an understanding of psychology. Its methods will doubtless be tried in other southern cities. Whether they will have the same effect is an unanswerable question. Albany is, in many ways, a special case. Not every city is willing or able to meet nonviolence with nonviolence. Today, Albany is a study in frustration. The whites are frustrated, the Negroes are frustrated, even the federal government is frustrated. But frustration is no stranger to the South, nor is it likely to be for a long time to come. This is Charles Collingwood. Good night.
Eyewitness, the Albany Movement. This program has been brought to you by Polaroid Corporation, makers of the Polaroid Land Camera. Broadcast pre-recorded is produced by CBS News, which has sole responsibility for the news, judgments, the content, and editing. This is Harry Kramer speaking.
An extraordinary meeting is taking place inside this lavish 100... Ah, come on, Wallace! An extraordinary meeting is taking place inside this lavish 100-room turn-of-the-century home built by robber baron E.H. Harriman. Half a hundred of America's top business...
Forget it. Rolling. Lamp, back a half inch. Steady.
An extraordinary meeting is taking place inside this lavish 100-room turn-of-the-century home built by robber baron E.H. Harriman. Half a hundred of America's top corporation executives and board chairmen have gathered to talk about the welfare problems of the Negro poor. All right, keep it going. That was just right. What are you shaking your head for? Just right. An extraordinary meeting is taking place inside this lavish 100-room turn-of-the-century home built by robber baron E.H. Harriman. Half a hundred of America's top corporation executives, presidents, and board chairmen have gathered to talk about the welfare problems of the Negro poor. The family allowance that you talk about, what would you detail it for us?
Well, one of the attractions of the family allowance is that there aren't many details. It's a system of flat monthly payments to the parents of minor children. 62 countries in the world have it. The United States is the only industrial democracy in the world that doesn't. It begins with the proposition that most men, when they're raising children, don't get necessarily a raise in their income, and their costs are higher, they need more. While you're raising the children, just give the money to help with the kids. And there's not a country in the world that has this system that would ever dream, wonders how they ever got along without it. I mean, it's a popular, efficient, easy system, does not require great bureaucracy, does not divide the country in between those people who pay for it and those people who get paid it.
What about those who simply don't need the money and who get it nonetheless?
Well, most of them will pay most of it back in income tax. And, you know, President Kennedy used to say life is not fair. Some people are luckier than others. And there's a price you ought to be willing to pay to get a simple and efficient system going. The effort to find out who needs and who doesn't need, how much you need, why you need, is exactly what's behind so much of the misery of welfare.
How large would these payments be, Dr. Moynihan?
Well, if we had the equivalent of the Canadian system, I think it would be about $8 a month for a child up to age 6 and $12 a month for a child up to age 17, until he turned 18. Maybe for a family of 4, upwards of $50 a month. Not a lot, perhaps, but a big difference in the lives of people who are right on the margin of earning any money, but not quite enough.
It would come out of tax money, obviously, and in the aggregate, cost how much?
I think an $8 and $12 payment would cost about $9 billion a year. Sounds like a lot, but that's about 2 years' growth in the federal income tax structure of routine tax increments. It's the kind of money you invest in your children. It's the kind of money you don't waste.
Perfect. Cut. Let's get two shots.
The president released today a document on the social and economic conditions of Negroes in the United States and made some points about it. And it's an outrage. We know less about the most important social problem in this country than would be required of a sophomore at Harvard University on the whole range of English literature. I mean, we don't know anything about it. And in the last 3 years in which we've known it to be our problem, we have not learned anything about it. Just a recitation of routine indices that have existed for the last 15 years, sanitized to take out those that might cause anybody any embarrassment, and yet somehow also expected to drive the Congress on to yet further efforts to raise income taxes. This summer, in the midst of the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee introduced in the last day of the hearings on the Social Security law, the most punitive, abusive, regressive measures on welfare that have ever been heard of in the American capital. Had they been introduced into Gladstone's parliament, they'd have caused an outrage. And they passed the House of Representatives with four dissenting votes, those four votes being four Southern racists who didn't think they were tough enough. Take the four dissenting votes, put the women to work, fix the limit on the number of children, find the fathers of the illegitimate kids. I mean, absolutely savage legislation. And the administration in Washington said nothing, did nothing, acted as Mayor Lindsay went down and said, this law passes, it'll cause a thundering crisis in New York City. There had not been a word in Washington about it, except we wish you didn't do that, Mr. Mills, but will you please pass that increase in the income tax?
It's not better.
We probably have to anticipate, no matter what we do, a long lead time before any measures we now take are going to have any real consequences. And if the laws that have passed the House of Representatives become, in fact, if the bills passing the House become law, I think we can anticipate a very severe.
In the welfare recipients in the planning of a welfare program.
Well, I would.
There are no welfare recipients on this board. There are lots of businessmen.
That's right.
There are no welfare recipients, and here you have a pivotal conference and a major national conference on welfare, and he excludes welfare recipients.
Well,
I want you to convey that directly to
all right, I will.
Governor Rockefeller is going to have to take responsibility for that personally.
No,
himself.
I'm going to take responsibility for that decision myself,
George.
And I'm telling you.
In a church in Washington's northeast ghetto, the 130 Negroes from Alabama's Black Belt who came to Washington to testify in federal district court. But none of them ever reached the witness stand. The case is about food, or about the lack of it. The Alabama farm families made the trip to testify about the problems of getting surplus food or food stamps. Attorneys representing them say the U.S. Department of Agriculture should make food stamps available free to families with very low or no income. And they brought some of the families along to testify to the conditions of malnutrition in their area. But the decision in court went against them.
The judge commented, if you want me to agree with you that these laws have certain defects as far as taking care of the needs of poor people are concerned, I couldn't agree with you more. However, he interpreted both the food stamps and the commodity laws as primarily agricultural laws, not welfare laws, and told the plaintiffs that their remedy lies with the Congress. Then he dismissed the suit. The people from Alabama's Black Belt plan another appeal. Nelson Denton, CBS News, Washington.
Most recent crusades against segregation in the South have used churches. Most crusades against segregation in the South in recent years have used churches as headquarters. The Albany movement is no exception. This is one of three churches, three Negro churches in Albany, that have alternated as locations for mass meetings designed primarily as sort of integration pep rallies, with the song the focal point of each rally. When Dr. Martin Luther King came down from Montgomery, Alabama last month to give the Albany movement impetus, he told these people that the road to integration would require unity and patience, as well as courage. Shortly after that, these people saw Reverend King go to jail for demonstrating. He is still in jail. Attendance has been down for most of the week is the fact that over 1,000 Negroes are in local jails. Not all of them here in Albany. Some have been taken to jails in outlying communities. Depends on these people. They are the heart of it. This is CBS News in Albany, Georgia.
and in Terrell County. And you know some of the hardships that we go through. You know that sometimes we don't have food. Sometimes we don't have transportation. Sometimes we have to pick cotton or pick cucumbers. But we can't afford to forget the thousands of people, I tell you, thousands of people around in this section. Because Albany is the only urban section in this entire Southwest Georgia area. The only urban section. And these people have to come to Albany. We've written as the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee in our student voice to you time and time again that these people look to you. They've got nobody else to look for, toward. They can't look to our white brothers because our white brothers are victims of the system. The same system that incarcerates us. The same system that will send me to jail Monday past for trying to get people to exercise their constitutional guarantees. It makes me wonder, what are we about in our country? Can you imagine? Just 3 weeks ago, I was standing in the tax collector's room. So two white brethren, came up to me on my right. In exactly the same place where Ralph was arrested Monday, paradoxically. Standing in that same place, and on my left-hand side, there stood a policeman staring down at me. As if I were going to melt, you know, under the pressure of his eyes. And so these men on my right demanded that I give them my name. Now, I don't have to give my name to anybody. But right there, and he came to such a peak in his emotion that he whipped open his lapel of his coat and showed me his gun hanging under his shoulder. You know how they have these guns strapped under their shoulder, and said, I'd asked him who was he. If he had told me that he was an FBI agent, if he had told me that he was a policeman, and I might have given him my name, and I don't have to give a policeman or FBI or anybody my name unless I want to. But I probably would have given it to him, but he showed me, now here's who I am, as if I'm supposed to be afraid. But these are the kinds of intimidation that we face daily in Terrell County, in Lee County. Just the other day, last week also, one of our SNCC workers, Penelope Patch, who's working with us, she's from Swarthmore, but she's down here working in voter registration. She went to Smithfield trying to get people to register there. And she was told by one of the officers there to get out of town. And that if she returned, that she would be picked up on a vagrancy charge with a fine up to $1,000, I understand. See, every day, any old day of the week, this is what we have confronted us. But we don't mind. We don't mind it. Because when we came here, I remember, it was from the same pulpit, if you remember, those of you who were members of this church and were present that day, I told you that we have only our minds and our bodies to offer. And we offer them willingly. But before I be a slave, and this has been my conviction for a long time ago. Before I be a slave, I will be buried in my grave. And I mean it. Don't get weary. Endure to the end. What does the Bible say about it? Victory is not to the swift or to the strong, but to him who holdeth out to the end. We got to hold out. I tell you that God is speaking. God is speaking here in Albany, Georgia. And all you got to do is give a listen. And you hear him speaking. He's speaking through the courts. And he's speaking through our marching here in Georgia. And all we got to do is hold out. Thank you. God bless you.
Which way we are going? We are going higher and higher and higher and higher and higher. And we want the power structure downtown to learn the lesson that was taught by Booker T. Washington some 50 years ago. The only way to keep a man in the ditch is to stay down there with him. And if they think they're going to keep the Negro in Albany in the ditch, they'd better look around and get some more thoughts, because it isn't going to happen. So I'm going to ask that we all stand and sing "We Shall Overcome" and go home and get a good night's rest.